suppose some Mafiadon isn't being paid by a, you know, some guy, a grocer or something. He doesn't go after a court order to get the money. He doesn't want a court order. He wants to send his goons in to beat him to a pulp, you know? That's called credibility.
If we were to leave before the mission is complete, it would hurt U.S. credibility.
If this little nation goes down the drain, ask yourself what's going to happen to all the other little nations.
I still think we ought to take the rights off now. I think that drama
so the Cold War, in effect, was a war of the United States against the Third World and of Russia against its much smaller domains in Eastern Europe. Each great power used the other's threats as a pretext.
The major objectives in Vietnam are pretty much what they were in Cuba, Guatemala, Nicaragua, Congo, all around the world. They were afraid that Vietnam was going to undergo successful social and economic development, and as it's put in high places, the rot might spread to others. It might lead to ideological victories for the mode of socioeconomic development that they're pursuing. The virus might infect others, as Kissinger put it with regard to Chile. Well, when you have a virus, what do you do with it? You kill the virus and you inoculate the potential victims, and that's what happened. Indochina was killed. Maybe it'll survive, but it's not going to be a model for anything. And the surrounding region was inoculated. In the 60s and early 70s, the U.S. succeeded in installing brutal and vicious military dictators in every country. And that stopped the, prevented the rot from spreading.
I always found when in any discussion on war, inevitably, in any discussion on war, at a certain point in the discussion, somebody would say, oh, well, it's human nature. First of all, from my own experience, and I still have to tell this to people because there are still people who talk about the desire of young men to go to war, the thrill it is for young men to be in war, to shoot their guns, to kill. And I thought about my own experience in the Air Force, and it was very clear to me, looking around at all these guys around me who were dropping bombs and who were killing people, that did not come from inside. It did not come from, oh God, how good it would be to kill some people today. You know, there was no urge to kill, even though they were the enemy. No, what it came from was simply we had been trained. And also we had been told it's a good war. We've been told we're the good guys, they're the bad guys. It's be bad if they won, it'll be good if we win. We've got to drop the bombs. And then when I got away from my own experiences and just began to study history and history of wars, something else became clear to me. And that is, wars don't take place out of the rush of a population demanding war. It isn't the population that demands war, it's the leaders who demand war and who prepare the population for war.
Saddam Hussein has gone to elaborate lengths, spent enormous sums, taken great risks to build and keep weapons of mass destruction.
Saddam Hussein is determined to get his hands on a nuclear bomb.
Nuclear weapon.
Nuclear weapon.
Nuclear weapon.
Active chemical munitions bunkers, mobile production facilities.
We know he's got chemical weapons. He's got them. He's got them. He's got them.
And it was clear to me from looking at the works of anthropologists, there were some tribes that were fierce and some tribes that were peaceful. It clearly wasn't a universal quality. It depended on the conditions under which they lived. And this guy Colin Turnbull wrote books about the forest people and the mountain people. And the forest people, the pygmies of the forest, lived under the kind of conditions which made them violent. The people in the mountains were living under different kinds of conditions, and they were peaceful. So, you know, I just didn't see any scientific evidence. And also the word aggression is a very ambiguous term. Because you can take out your aggressions in many ways. You don't have to take it out by killing people.
But what we have in history is the fact that when surplus value develops, when there's more than a subsistence economy, you have some portion of the population that will do everything it can to enslave and to expropriate the labor of the rest of the people. And one of the things that's used in that arrangement is a very conscious instrument of control.
Don't tase me, bro!
An organization that has a monopoly on the legitimate uses of force and violence. And that instrument is called the state.
They won't loot slaves' power. And with this, they don't get them.
And there's a current version of that, a crude version by Thomas Friedman, who says that McDonald's cannot flourish without McDonnell Douglas, meaning the U.S. Air Force.
I was invited to Washington, D.C. to attend this meeting that was being put together by the National Security Agency called the Critical Thinking Consortium. I remember standing there in this room and looking over on one side of the room, and we had CIA, NSA, DIA, FBI, Customs, Secret Service, and then on the other side of the room we had Coca-Cola, Mobile Oil, GTE, and Kodak. And I remember thinking, I am like in the epicenter of the intelligence industry right now. I mean, the line is not just blurring, it's just not there anymore.
But don't you sometimes need big government to deal with big business, that in a sense there is a kind of balance between these large forces?
It's like saying there's a balance between two members of the board of directors of General Motors. Yes, there's some kind of a balance, but they're so closely interlinked and they're connected that they're, to first approximation, they're the same thing.
Of course, this doesn't mean that some governments are not better than others, or that governments cannot offer a certain degree of protection against market forces. It doesn't mean that the public cannot have a certain degree of democratic influence over government, or that they cannot have more influence over government than they do over totally undemocratic institutions like corporations. After all, most of the freedoms that we enjoy in the West have been the product of successful grassroots struggles, like the civil rights movement, the labor movement, the women's movement, etc., which were able to influence and constrain governments, corporations, and other elite institutions, which subsequently took credit for the freedoms gained by these struggles. What it means is that freedoms are usually not a gift from above, and that when they are either incidental or they foster dependence and subordination, creating hierarchy.
Thank you.
Government, whether it calls itself Republican, Democrat, Socialist, Capitalist, Communist, or whatever, is a means by which a minority controls a majority, either by itself or in conjunction with other powerful entities like corporations. Here, the concept of property is important. Having property for personal use and need, like a home, a bed, a toothbrush, etc., does not require government. But when one's private property extends beyond those items to the means of production, like industries, large swaths of land, or any property that is not for personal use, then the need for government appears. When property is used to deprive others of access to the basic necessities of life, or when property is used to derive profit at the expense of others without having to work, simply by granting permission to use the means of production, then the need for government appears.
Till there be property, there can be no government. The very end of which is to secure wealth and to defend the rich from the poor.
The great and chief end of men's uniting into commonwealths and putting themselves under government is the preservation of their property.
Those who own the country ought to govern it.